highest official of the SAIG and his team. Thank you. Dr. Fernando Cheung. In this council, and also the resistance in this council and also the resistance outside are to damage Hong Kong and damage the interests of Hong Kong, then you have to remember that this is the election year, and last year it was also the election year. If we are to do damage, we wouldn't have won the elections. The pro-establishment and this government have to consider their own logic. They have to consider their thinking. We are resisting a draconian law. We are resisting a wrong policy. And yet you are not able to understand this. Now concerning the hatred between the students and the police, Mr. Wong, a police officer, suffers the most serious injury. He has no hatred. He asks all to pay attention to the problem, the young people. I pay my tribute to Mr. Wong. His spirit is something what we need in Hong Kong, and we should work towards this. We don't want to breed more hatred. And Mr. Kevin Lau, in his article written during the umbrella movement, said that one should not allow hatred to breed. He advised the SAIG leaders. The majority of these officials don't want to see division in society, don't want to see the growth of hatred. You understand that the political issues should be resolved through political means, and you should not make use of the disciplined forces to solve the problem by force. Please promote dialogue and put an end to hatred. Mr. Chen Kien-po. Thank you, Mr. President. Now, many members say that peace and reason cannot solve problems, and therefore many netizens support violence. I oppose this wrong argument. Any argument that justifies violence is poisoning young people, is throwing young people down the pit in order to achieve ulterior motives. That may be because for political mission or for other ulterior motives. We should care for young people. We should treasure young people, lead them to the right track instead of beautifying violence so that they get deeper into the pit. I oppose any kind of violence. Violence cannot solve any problem. Can anyone achieve success through violence? If you resort to violence, then there will be escalation of violence, and many people will be will suffer. In the Lunar New Year Day, on the Lunar New Year Day, those who suffer may be the reporters, the police, or the rioters. They have a common point. They are humans and they are Chinese. Now we must condemn this crime. Young people only see the superficial phenomenon of society. They just look at some media, some type of internet media. Maybe their teachers only teach them that. Blame the government. They think the government, society, and family members cannot help them, and they have to deal with it by their own means. When they face external stimulation, they can easily follow their impulses. If they have thought that many people will be injured and they would face 10-year imprisonment, and that would harm their future, that would put pressure on their family members, then not so many young people would have participated in such extreme activities. The government has to pay attention to this, understand the full course of the matter. Of course, we have to penalize these people. The most important thing is to reduce their misunderstanding, allow them to express their opinions. We have found more and more false arguments. Is the government so bad? There is room for improvement on the part of the government, but as far as the senior officials, middle-level officials, I know they are committed to Hong Kong. They do what they should do. Just pointing fingers at the government has wrongly given the impression to young people that this is a lawless society. You know that Hong Kong is very efficient. Many services and welfare policies are better than other parts of the world. And if you keep saying that they are bad, if you keep banging your head against the wall, is it good for Hong Kong? If any member of this council use these specious arguments to lead young people down the right track, they are the chief culprits of Hong Kong. And they will take the greatest responsibility. The government should do its part and lead young people not to think along a single track and feel that the government has given them a raw deal. Many people care for young people and they suffer from pressure. They work for the people of Hong Kong. They work for young people. The government should learn the lessons. Once violence have started, there is no stop. It will become the normal course of the matter. The government should review the security arrangements when people tend to gather, say, in Mong Kok, in Causeway Bay, in Tsim Sha Tsui, in the central. There should be suitable preparation arrangement of dispersion of the crowd, and there should be improvement to existing municipal amenities so that they will not become weapons. And the police should also be better prepared and improve their patrolling. Now, in many places where there is universal suffrage, they have more problems than ours. They have higher youth unemployment rate, more economic problems, higher unemployment rates. How can you explain that? Now, the political reform package has not been passed. Our political system cannot have any improvement in the short term. Can we just bang our head against the wall and ask people, young people, to take to the streets and become rioters? Or should we not let young people see the whole picture? We shouldn't allow young people to be brainwashed. The government should set up a dedicated force to follow up on the education, employment, marriage, and also buying a home. If the government keep working on this, they will feel the sincerity of the government. You may not be able to achieve a lot, but you have to let people see that you work for their interests, you do it for their interests. And you put them as your priority. If you cannot allow them to see that, then that knot cannot be untied. I believe the youth problem cannot be resolved by political struggle. You need to let young people understand the reality of our economic problems. Ours is a mature economy. You cannot simplify the issue and lead young people to think in the wrong direction. I was very poor, and I am able to move up the social ladder. Now, you can say that during your days there was economic growth, and therefore you can brag about it. Now, but if I were to become younger by 30 years or 40 years, when I face a more difficult situation, will I work harder or will I just give up? Now, Hong Kong has become more difficult, but I have come across many employers who complain that they cannot find young people who can work harder for the company instead of being very mean. Many employers are looking for aspiring young persons. Many young people want to get rich quick. I hope young people understand that if you are dedicated to your work and you work hard for your future, you will get the results. Young people have to think about it.
我希望下一次 年輕人如果拿起磚頭的時候,
next time when young people pick up the bricks, they have to consider when they throw that piece of brick, that may change his whole life. That may change his family. And they will face 10 years of imprisonment. The brick may hit another citizen, may hit a police officer, may hit a reporter. They may be injured, they may be killed. After that, have you given them a fair deal? They have families. They also have families. I hope you really think hard on this. Don't be misled by newspapers, magazines, and legislative counselors, and believe that you have done something right. I hope you will go back to the right track, fight for your future. Don't rely on the government. Don't rely on political parties. Rely on your brains and your fist. I believe what I said is good for you. Thank you. Does any member wish to speak? Mr. Cheng Hang Pan.
剛出爐的施政報告是一份完整、詳盡、務實的施政報告。民建聯居安思危、促經。The
policy address is a detailed policy address, has responded to the call of the DAB, and it seeks for harmony and protect people's livelihood. It has also provided a long-term plan so that Hong Kong can grasp the opportunity of development of our country. And in terms of people's livelihood, it covers improving health care, developing smart city, caring for the disadvantaged, caring for the elderly. There are many specific proposals, and the DAB subscribes to them all. The emphasis of the policy address is the Belt Road initiatives and also the innovation and technology, and people feel that they are very distant from us. But we have to understand that all the supportive measures given to the disadvantaged have to rely on financial means, and without economic development, where does the money come? Now, the economy has reached a plateau. There is a decline in tourism industry and retail industry. We face challenges in our economy. The Belt Road initiatives and innovation and technology provide internal and external impetus for our economy. The long-term plan provided by the CE in the area of innovation and technology includes an innovation technology a $2 billion fund, and then there is a venture fund, and there is also a fund to improve people's living through technology, and then $200 million in the cyberport for incubation of new enterprises. Finally, there is real activity, real support given to the innovation technology sector. Industries will benefit, and people will be benefited as well. As for coping with population aging, we can see the sincerity and the measures. There is consultation on retirement protection, and there are also improvement measures on caring for the elderly.
And this includes service places for the elderly and the promotion of elderly community services, optimizing passenger links and access, and more elderly friendly measures. And the network for youth and elderly would be promoted, and more information will be provided to the elderly. And some barrier-free access ramps, escalators, lifts, outdoor seating will be installed. And a lot of people feel that these belong to the work of district councils. And this is inappropriate in policy address. I don't agree with that, although these might sound trivial, but nonetheless, they are very important to the livelihoods of the elderly. In the last few years, the chief executive installed more than 10 escalators and elevators in Kowloon East. Some are in the pipeline and some are completed. And they have finally been implemented in the current term administration. Without these lifts and escalators, the elderly would face a lot of inconvenience. So these are substantial enhancements to the livelihoods of these elderly. The government should not ignore the livelihoods of these elderly, and the opposition should not stand against the government. And the new business district in Kowloon East can provide ample office space. The two government lots at Kowloon Bay have been sold. More than 120,000 square meters of commercial floor space would be available. The development of Kowloon East can ease the pressure on rents and commercial space, and it can also help with the overall economic development in Kowloon East. And however, during the morning and evening rush hours in the densely populated areas in Kwun Tong, for instance, Ngatau Kok, Kwun Tong MTR, Kowloon Bay MTR, etc., there are very long queues outside minibus and bus stops, and public transport is drained. The main link roads in Kowloon East are often congested. If we introduce even more commercial buildings without corresponding measures, there will be even more congestion at the main roads, which would affect the public. I hope the government can conduct more planning in this front. I'm happy that the government is introducing a pilot scheme to Kowloon East on the payment of link premium for the construction of pedestrian links. I hope the government can do something to separate vehicles with pedestrians. At the same time, I hope the government can fulfill its promise in building a monorail system in Kai Tak in order to alleviate congestion. And on top of the pedestrian link in on Kwun Tong Road, a covered walkway should be installed, and signs for waiting signs for at bus stops should be built, and a major transport interchange should be built, and bus services should be streamlined in order to improve the waiting areas and enhance efficiency of bus service, and that in turn will ease congestion in Kwun Tong. Hong Kong faces external uncertainties, and we face a number of challenges with fluctuating oil prices globally and with volatility in the global security market, including the mainland market. The renminbi is being manipulated, and we are facing exceptional volatility in the global arena, and Hong Kong is no exception. And these external factors are affecting Hong Kong's business environment. And Hong Kong is not doing so well either in terms of economy. Tourism is one of the four pillar industries, and it's facing unprecedented challenges. And it's also affected by other industries. Last year, for the traditional industries of retail trade have gone down. According to government statistics, in November last year, the overall number of inbound visitors reached 4.74 million, down 10.4% from last year. It was the sixth straight month of drop. And the number of inbound mainland visitors was only 310,000, down 15% from last year. And the annual number of inbound mainland visitors went down by 20%, and tourism was affected. And due to external uncertainties, the sales volume in Hong Kong have gone down for 9 straight months. In November last year, the total sales volume was $38 billion, down 7% from the previous year, and the total volume of goods sold also went down by 8%. For the third quarter alone, the drop in sales volume reached 23%. So a lot of merchants decided to leave the busy business areas for Tsim Sha Tsui, Mong Kok, and Causeway Bay. The rents of shopfronts went down by 20 to 50%. The shop vacancy rates increased to 4 to 6%. And we have seen sharp drops recently after the Lunar New Year. And we expect vacancy rates to climb further. And right now, employment rate in Hong Kong is very high. However, due to deteriorating situation for the catering and hospitality industries, the unemployment might rise. We should focus our energies on tackling these issues. But given the political climate of Hong Kong at the moment, the problems would only worsen. Hong Kong's long-standing reputation as a tourism hub, and starting from the Occupy movement in September 2014, as well as incidents in the universities and the Mong Kok riot, these are saddening incidents. The friendly image of Hong Kong has all but evaporated. The world is no longer reporting on Hong Kong's beauty and tourism appeal, but instead, rioters who place bombs outside Legco and young people who beat up police officers. We have seen repeats of violence. So who would want to come to Hong Kong now? Now, if the confusion continues, the confidence of overseas investors will be affected, and it will lead to social instability, and we cannot attract new capital. Even existing capital might be drained. And some commentators pointed out that political instability is not the biggest problem. A bigger issue is this internal struggles. We face, Hong Kong faced a lot of challenges, including the oil price hikes, the 1997 Asian financial crisis, the 2003 SARS incident, the financial crisis in 2008, and Hong Kong managed to overcome them all. But if we continue to see internal struggles, no one can guarantee that Hong Kong will be able to overcome all these obstacles. Mr. President, the situation is worrying for Hong Kong, and the Legislative Council has a responsibility as well. Some parties and members try to make everything political, and they resort to filibustering, calling for quorum and so on. They are hindering the administration, and they are trying to divide up our society. And the opposition is encouraging violence, and as such, we have more and more violence in and outside of the Legislative Council. Let's take the Mong Kok riot as an example. The opposition is still placing blames. They are not condemning the rioters, but they are trying to rationalize the violence in Mong Kok, and they are blaming the government's governance, and they are confusing black and white and trying to create confusion. At a special meeting at the security panel, and members voted on a motion on condemnation of violence. Some PAN Democrats abstained from the vote. Nine members from the PAN Democratic camps voted against the motion. So we can see they have no intention to condemn violence. On the other hand, they are happy to see this chaos in Hong Kong. Thanks to the PAN Democrats, how can the people of Hong Kong have confidence in our future? How can you blame the riot on governance? The Hong Kong indigenous who instigated the riot has always promoted Hong Kong independence. They promoted violence and unrest. The cause of riot is not to fight for democracy or to protect the hawkers. The real objective is for Hong Kong to become independent. These are separatists, obviously, and they are unwilling to be governed by the Hong Kong SAR government. The so-called localist movement is essentially a separatist movement, and the PAN Democrats are trying to side with these separatists, and in the name of localism, they are trying to disrupt one country, two systems. Mr. Raymond Wong, I've heard what he said. I agree that he's not being logical, and he's only trying to stand against the government. We are not able to achieve consensus in Hong Kong, but at least the majority of the people are being taken care of. And Hong Kong people are not living in hardship. They are not living in oppression and disappointment. The unemployment is around 3.3%, the lowest in history. Economic growth stands at 3 to 4%, which is one of the top performance in Hong Kong. So you cannot say that the Hong Kong government is a tyranny. Dr. Helen Wong compared young people with stones and fire, but is violence the way out? Or are they going to jeopardize their own future? History told us that the person who throws the brick will eventually suffer, and they will pay the price at the end. Filibustering electoral is another form of violence, and we saw agendas stacked up, whether for infrastructure and welfare issues, they have all stagnated. And according to the construction industry, the government invests about $70 billion on capital works every year, but due to filibustering, and in 2013 to 14 or 14 to 15, only $3.6 billion worth of works were approved. And as of now, only $407 million were approved. And with more delays, the cost will further increase. And the tender prices will only get higher and higher. And the increase in construction costs is attributable to members who continue to filibuster. They have to be held responsible.
The malicious intention means that the whole society will have to pay a price. Now, some people said that we are paid, but we should not be complimenting the government blindly. Well, we'll praise what's right and condemn what's wrong. But then, legislators who are paid should not engage in filibustering and should not be absent from meetings and use every ways and means to stand in the way of passage of bills. Now, if we politicize everything, this is not something that we should do. Let's take the example of the collocation arrangements of the XRL. This is supposedly to facilitate the mutual exchanges in the economies of the two places. And this is supposed to be something good. But then some people were saying that this will undermine one country, two systems. And all of a sudden, this becomes a center of criticisms. In many overseas countries, co-location is in place. Why can't we do it in Hong Kong? Those who question this, their reasons do not stand. Well, even if the government said that we will compromise and we will first talk about co-location, and if that can't be done, then that, well, only separate co-location or separate locations will be put in place. This can be discussed later, but then the opposition camp members would not like to discuss XRL, and they are using this distorted argument about co-location. They want to block the passage of the funding application. And August 2014, we are talking about the Copyright Amendment Bill. This is supposed to be a bill which will facilitate the development of the creative industries, and so that we will be on a par with international over jurisdictions. But then this was supposed, they criticized this as restricting the freedom of expression. Now, we've consulted many years over the bill. We held 24 bills committees meeting, and the issues of contention have been deliberated upon by many over the years by both the government and the sector, and the pros and cons have been duly deliberated, and the Bar Association has made its stance clear several times, and they have given the explanations on the contentious issues. And Winnie Tam, the chair of the Bar Association, also pointed out that those who are familiar with the law are trying to scare people by their remarks. Well, even if this is the case, the pan-democrats continue to filibuster in the council, and they would like to scrap the bill altogether. So this has nothing to do with really the content of the bill, but rather it's a struggle between the various factions, and the filibustering becomes a tactics, and the pan-democrats have forgotten their responsibilities as legislators. On Wednesday, we held a four-party meeting, and the pan-democrats think this is an achievement. I don't see it that way. The four-party meeting was held in response to the aspirations of the parties to resolve the matter, and the meeting, I find it very saddening, because the society is very divided, and even if we are going to sit down and try to resolve issues, and things are still difficult, and some people just walked out of the meeting. So this is a very divided society, and each party insists on its own stance and doesn't want to make any compromise, and this is most worrying. And I'm also disappointed by this, and I hope that the various sides can further consider the situation we are facing, or else the society will still be in an impasse and there will still be a lot of controversies. I hope that we can go back to rationality and we can take a pragmatic approach and we can return to a normal society. Mr. Chen Hanpen, well, in the violent actions in the past and also the riots in Mong Kok, we saw acts which are undermining the rule of law, and these actions are getting more radical. People are disregarding the law altogether. How come people are so bold, getting bolder these days? Well, in the past, we knew that we had to take responsibility if we break the law. But after the occupation movement and also the Mong Kok riots, some people in the legal sector are providing pro bono services to the rioters, and they even went so far as to say that this is a charitable act. And this gave people the illusion that, well, no matter, even if you break the law, there's some people to help you out, will bail you out, and this is like a firewall and refuge island for these violent activists. And these are actually inciting the people to do such actions, and people are not fearful of anything these days because the people's guts are made stronger by such acts. I respect that I uphold the fact that everyone should have legal representation, but then should we not respect the rule of law, or should we be trying to crash the bottom line of rule of law? Well, I hope that those parties who uphold the principle of rule of law, they should practice what they preach, and they should urge the young people to go to the right track. Well, if they are inciting people to do violent acts, will they also encourage their children to do the same? Hong Kong is governed by the rule of law, and this is something that we cherish, and we should uphold it. But then, if there are so many legal firewalls, refuge island, then that doesn't help preserving the rule of law. So I submit Mr. Lam Tai Fai. Thank you, President. In the past few years, Hong Kong is in great turmoil. We go by every day with a lot of problems. The economy has come to a standstill. There are many livelihood issues with a lot of problems, education, transport, housing, and so on. And then the grassrooters are having a difficult time. The young people don't have any upward social mobility. And what is most pathetic is that Hong Kong people don't find it safe living in Hong Kong. And their safety, personal safety and property safety are under threat. Now, we've seen the occupation movement, the riots in Mong Kok, and the Lee Bo incident. The law-abiding Hong Kong people, they get worried and scared. Now, if they said that they are not scared, they are not just cheating themselves, but also others as well. Now, if a government doesn't provide an environment where people can live and work safely and can't safeguard people's personal safety, people have to live in fear, then this kind of government is negligent in its duties, is an incompetent government, and it will not get support from people. It will not garner trust from Hong Kong people, and its work will not be recognized by the central authorities. President, I know that in the past few years, a lot of people don't agree to what Cy Leung has done. They don't appreciate his character. And some pan-democrats also question his integrity. I'm not very familiar with CE. I know that he's a person with vision. He's very observant. Let me set an example. After the election in 2012, he knew that Hong Kong must do something, we must develop. And then he said that we must build this Hong Kong camp. And he encourages the various sectors to narrow down their differences, and we should have work united and foster harmony. I remember Wang Guangya, the director of Hong Kong Macau Affairs Office, agreed to his remarks, and he joins in this appeal to ask the sectors to narrow down their differences and take the overall interest of Hong Kong as a whole, and then Hong Kong will win. But regrettably, things don't develop in the way we wished. We lose. Out this time, we made a heavy loss, and we were seriously injured, and the society is seriously damaged. In the past few years, the society has become more divided. People are pitting against each other, and that includes the conflict between the government and the people, legislature and executive, and among the political parties. And these conflicts are escalating as well. There has been so much bickering, so many conflicts in the society. And these are not just conflicts within the society, but also conflicts between Hong Kong and the mainland. So I believe that this is not something that is expected, not just by Huang Guangya, but also the central authorities and the 100 1.36 billion compatriots on the mainland don't want to see this as well. It's been 17 years after the handover. We've had three CEs, and the governance is going, is deteriorating. The political situation is deteriorating. The society is getting unstable. People's mind, people are getting more worried, and people are losing faith in the government, and they don't support it. So does it mean that Hong Kong people can't aren't capable of Hong Kong people administering Hong Kong, and we are capable to govern Hong Kong under the high degree of autonomy and one country, two systems principle? I believe that the central authorities are studying the situation in Hong Kong day after day. Mr. President, in the community, including in the electoral, there is this unhealthy phenomenon and situation. A lot of pro-government people, they will blindly support the government, and they can't differentiate what is right and wrong. And there are some others who are opposing the government. They will not talk about facts. They would oppose the government just for the sake of opposition. They oppose the government on everything. And people are getting irrational. We are not getting self-restrained. And what the government is doing every day, they are trying to fight a fire, and they try to lobby people for their support. They don't have the time. They can't spare the time to do concrete things for Hong Kong people and the society, and they can only take one step at a time in their governance. Mr. President, you are a highly intelligent person, and you should understand that if we want a way out for Hong Kong, we want to do something for Hong Kong, we must compromise. We must have mutual accommodation. Give Hong Kong a chance. If the government fights against the opposition camp, and then the supporters of each side are trying to fan into the fuel, and that the government doesn't want to change its governance approach and try to sincerely talk to the various sectors, including the young people, they are just paying lip service. They are just drafting these few words in the policy address saying that it will foster harmony. It's nothing but a slogan to me. And if that goes on, I am afraid that Hong Kong will go down the drain and will collapse. And the victims, who are they? The Hong Kong people and our nation. The policy address mentions that we should participate in the Belt and Road Initiative. We should develop Hong Kong to a smart city, an IT center, innovation and technology center. Well, it will all just be empty talk, Mr. President. I am born and bred in Hong Kong. I've lived here for over 50 years. I've never thought about leaving Hong Kong, because all along, I've thought that Hong Kong is a place where I can live and work happily. It's a free, open, and safe city. But in the past few years, I am getting unfamiliar with this place, which I have lived in for over 50 years. I find that Hong Kong is getting more uncivilized, unsafe. It's like an explosive magazine, full of grievances, full of anger. The government, the political parties, and the Hong Kong people are pointing fingers at each other. They are slamming and criticizing each other. There is so much negative energy in this society. I am very frustrated. Honestly speaking, I feel suffocated.
The current situation, the current state, it's like this, and neither the government nor political parties are willing to reflect on their own behavior. They are not willing to concede. They will just continue to confront one another. So they do not admit their mistakes. They are not willing to go back to the right track. So we have this problem of a highly polarized society. Can the rift be mended? Can it mend by itself? I don't think so. President, I believe many people will share my sentiments. They feel that living in Hong Kong now is very puzzling, and we feel anxious, baffled, and sometimes even painful. Society is no longer like what it was. We've lost trust. There is no mutual respect, no accommodation, no mutual support. What's worse, that there are many people in community who have no respect for the law. They do not fear the police. They openly flout the law. They are unobjective. And many young people, as we can see in the Mongkok riot, do not fear the police. Why have this appeared? Why has this happened? And this government has no fear of lawsuits. The electoral reform package were lost by a wide margin. So we have not progressed an inch in democracy. The next CEO will be returned by a small circle. A CEO returned will not have any mandate or credibility. It will not get the support of the community. I believe the next term will find it more difficult to govern Hong Kong. Regardless who is the CEO, I believe he will have the ability to mend this rift, to salvage Hong Kong, to pull Hong Kong out of this problem, so that the central authorities can have the confidence to trust Hong Kong, allow us to have a high degree of autonomy, and Hong Kong people in Hong Kong may appeal to young people. Violence cannot be a solution. Any physical violence or violence in mind will not resolve any problems. It will only aggregate the situation. Thank you. Mr. Gary Chen. Thank you, President. We can more or less expect it. This motion of thanks on the PA is not really about the PA in particular. The Pan Democrats have put the focus on the riot in Hong Kong that happened on the first day of the new year. And they have not really talked too much about the policies. I'm a bit disappointed, because this session is supposed to be for governance, district administration, rule of law, so and so forth. Unfortunately, I have not much, have not heard much from them this morning. And what's even more regrettable, as of now, there are still many pan-democrats who beautify or whitewash the young people's role in the riot in Mongkok. They put the blame on the government. And Albert Ho said that anyone who will be able to see that it is in fact the government's problem. But that is really the objective of the rioters. Is it true? Is it really true that they are just unhappy with the government, with the government here? And some colleagues said that is because the high-handed officials have caused people to rebel. Are you saying that the colonial government was more lenient towards, public assembly than the current government? The cause of the Mongkok riot is arose because of those Hong Kong localists. They started all this under the pretext of protecting the hawkers. Well, from what we heard from the TV, they've always asked for Hong Kong to be a separate state. This is very clear, so there is no need for pan-democrats to defend them, saying that there is some problem with the governance of this SAR government trying to vindicate this rioters. Their purpose is very clear: to undermine the basic law and one country, two system. And they do not admit that Hong Kong is part of China. What we should do most here is exactly what the police have done, and that is to defend law and order and stability and prosperity of Hong Kong. We've seen Hong Kong's competitiveness declining, and we have been overtaken by many neighboring countries in terms of ranking in competitiveness and other economic indicators. And if we don't have the rule of law, I don't see how Hong Kong can compete with other Asian countries. And if we do not have stability and prosperity, how can we uphold our core values? Some pentamocrats said that the government has created system violence, and therefore we have the violent scenes in Mong Kok, and they have put such violence on a par with some historic figures such as Martin Luther King and Dr. Sun Yat-sen. But this is really shameful. Pan-Democrats, on the one hand, condemn violence, and on the other, they put these rioters on a par with historic role models. Many pan-Democrats mentioned Dr. Sun Yat-sen, saying that he used rationary means. He started the 1911 revolution to overthrow the Qing dynasty. However, Dr. Sun Yat-sen did recognize China. He loved China. He did not divide China. Sun Yat-sen was from Guangdong, and he never was for separatism. As all could see from the TV, these people wanted Hong Kong to be a separate state, and they have totally denied or say no to China. So how can the two be put together? After the riot in Mong Kok, I think the pan-Democrats have more or less they're more or less confused with their own position. They've been contradictory. Many pan-democratic members criticize the government today for not being able to reflect on their own behavior and performance. But do they, on the other hand, do they know how to reflect on their own behavior? Why should they be here to defend these rioters? As said in the PA, our disciplined services have been most dedicated and diligent in their duties, making Hong Kong one of the safest cities in the world, and therefore they do deserve our support and cooperation. After the Occupy movement and also the riot in Mong Kok, we can see that our police is not just dedicated and diligent, they are courageous, and they have also displayed extreme restraint, a constraint. I think our policemen are the only people who would brave the bricks themselves using their own body. You may have seen one police officer who was hurt, and he fell onto the ground, and his colleague didn't want him to be further hurt by bricks, and then he used his own back to protect his injured colleague. And I could see from the TV that a few bricks were thrown at him and actually hit him on his foot and back. So are our police officers violent or very self-restrained? We can see that for ourselves. And attacks at our police have been shown by TV reports, and is for everyone to see. So it is the rioters who are really violent. Members like to challenge our administration for not enforcing a piece of legislation enacted. That means once a piece of legislation is enacted, it's useless if it is not enforced although we are not very successful in enacting laws because of filibustering, luckily, our law enforcement agencies have worked very hard. The PA thank the civil service, but I think that is not sufficient to show our gratitude for the force, for the police force. Hong Kong is an open society. We're willing, we are able to accept any distorted arguments, even those from the pan-democrats. However, what we cannot swallow is blatant violence. I agree that our government is not perfect in all its moves, but that doesn't mean that we can legitimize the violence of the separatists. The is extremely dangerous and misleading for pan-democrats to mix the government's governance and the violence of the rioters. I hope they can return to reason. Please do not side with the rioters simply because they don't like this government. Thank you. Mr. Jeffrey Lam. President, freedom doesn't mean that you can do whatever you like, knowing no boundary. May I start anew, Chairman, President? As the PA said, as the CSA and the PA, we have to be vigilant of the security within Hong Kong. Well, the first day of the New Year, rioters set fire in Mong Kok. They assaulted the police and journalists. They risked the safety of the city, and we should support the police in enforcing the law and arresting these rioters. However, we should review the equipment and equipment of the police to ensure that they are properly armed to ensure the safety of themselves and the city. Now, they shouldn't be allowed to be assaulted without any protection. Police officers do not want to harm these protesters, but when faced with violence, they must use a minimum force to stop the troublemakers and to restore order. Some people may say, may think that by wearing a mask, they cannot be recognized and will not be arrested. I think we should support the police so that they have sufficient gear to collect evidence to ensure that unscrupulous elements will face penalty. Indeed, when people are masked, the threshold of proof is higher. So we should perhaps draw reference from overseas practice. Protesters shouldn't be banned from wearing face masks. If they think that what they think is right, then they should be open and show us their real identity. In fact, by so doing this, they may be able to secure more support. I have heard members of the public scolding these troublemakers that they dare to do this and dare not to reveal the identity. No matter how many excuses you use to defend them, you cannot deny that such behavior would affect the safety and life and property of people of the community. The basic law protects freedoms of expression, public assemblies, so on and so forth. However, that cannot be used as an excuse for violence. Stability is the cornerstone for Hong Kong people to live happily and peacefully, and it's also the prime consideration for overseas investors. We must not allow these mobsters to damage Hong Kong's image by disturbing our stability. In the last 3 days, many members have criticized the government ever so severely, and pan-democrats gave up filibustering for a while in order to scold the government. We know that no government can please everybody. Even the business sector has views about various policies, and they have submitted different views to the government. However, let's look at issues. Let us use reason to secure support and lobby for support, and please do not put the blame on individual officers, thinking that we can then resolve the problems.
Yesterday, the CS said that pro-establishment members are fairer, and therefore I would have to make a fair statement as well. Actually, government officials, civil servants, they are working hard for the people. They receive criticism or praises, but they continue to work hard. Even if they are criticized, they wouldn't point their fingers at anybody. We should support the government. CS, we support you. We support government officials who work hard to serve the people. The government should communicate with the people. There should be effective governance, and we should agree to disagree. Of course, you should work hard, but it takes two to tango. Political parties and other organizations should also take a step forward for the good of Hong Kong. When the external economic environment is not good, we should rebuild trust in society so Hong Kong can get on, so we can cope with the crises. But we have to find this way out. We should not just be pointing fingers. Let us all reflect upon ourselves. Thank you. Mr. Andrew Leung, President, this is the fourth motion of thanks debate I am moving. I have described legislature executive relationships in the past, saying that it's very tense, and this year I would say that it has dropped beyond zero. I actually did not intend to speak, but having followed the debate for 2 days, I can see that no one is happy. The pro-establishment camp is not happy, the pan-democrats are not happy, and the officials are not exactly happy. Objective data have shown us that Hong Kong actually is a good place. The Heritage Foundation has ranked Hong Kong as the freest economy for 22 years, and our per capita GDP ranks 6th in the world, and we are an international financial transport hub. We have full employment. However, Hong Kong people are not happy. There are many disputes and arguments in society. The public are aggrieved. We have had the Occupy movement. There was Occupy Mong Kok as well, and there was this violent event in Mong Kok at the beginning of the Chinese New Year. Those who are bosses find business rather difficult to maintain. The middle class think they are under burden because property prices are falling. They fear that the economy will not be good. When land premium rises, they feel that property prices will go up as well, so they cannot afford their own housing, and then the grassroots are having to pay more for daily necessities. Bhutan is viewed as the happiest country in the world, and it's strange. The per capita GDP is only $700. Why is it that it is the happiest country in the world? Many people went there in recent years to see why this country, which started with constitutional monarchy only in 2007, has become the happiest country in the world. Actually, recently the countries in the world have placed more emphasis on the happiness index of countries and their people. Starting from 2012, the United Nations adopted that. In 2012, out of we ranked 46th. In 2013, we ranked 64th, and 2014 we dropped further to 72nd. And then for Dubai, it had its own happiness index starting from 2014, and in 2013, Venezuela appointed a supreme minister for the happiness of the people, and he should coordinate all policies for the elderly, disabled children, and so on. A few days ago, the Emirates Arabic appointed their first minister of state for happiness.
in order to promote and adjust government policies so as to enhance the satisfaction of the people towards government policies and so that a better society can be constructed. So governments have been working to make people happy. Now, what about Hong Kong? In the past, our economy has slowed, and then we also blamed one another because property prices fluctuated. The bosses felt that the employees have not worked to the level best, and the employees felt that the bosses were not good to them. And the people said the officials did not do a good job, and then the officials said that the people did not understand that they had to balance the interests of different sectors, and they also had to look at the use of resources, etc. But then the government has lost its credibility and authority, and in the end, no one is happy. I don't know what the administration has thought about to find sources of happiness for Hong Kong people. So you find something to make the 7 million people happy, so there will be more accommodation in society, so the different sectors in society will not be pitched against one another, so that there is this friend of foe mentality. Very often in this council, we hold heated debates about government policies. We from the functional constituencies, of course, are concerned about the interests of the industries, and we hope we can secure protection of interest for our constituents. But then the labor sector members stand up against us. But you know, we don't get personal. Outside this chamber, we can still enjoy harmonious relationship and try to forge a consensus for the way forward. Aristotle said that to make people happy would mean that you achieve ultimate kindness. And for people to be happy, they need a certain degree of satisfaction. Hong Kong is a very affluent society. We need to continue to help those who don't have the ability to improve their lot, including elderly people and the disabled. But at the same time, the SALG should also seek to make the average person more happy. People now subjectively should be able to feel that Hong Kong is a happy place and not knit their brows all the time. Mr. President, we can see that more and more so when the government studies policies, they should also factor in the happiness index, and they should set happiness for the people at the top of their priority and make that the objective of their policy making. The SALG take reference from the World Center for Wellbeing of the UK and find new policies for the different bureaus. So policies can make people happy. Next week, the FS will deliver his budget. I hope the FS will make use of financial means to make Hong Kong people more happy. Thank you. Mr. Leung Yiu-chung, President, the PA is entitled Innovate for the Economy, Improve Livelihood, Foster Harmony and Share Prosperity. This is the beginning of the Year of the Monkey, and shortly after the delivery of the policy address, we had this Mongkok riot. The mobsters used steel bars and wooden staff to attack policemen. There was arson. And then in Shantung Street, Soi Street, and other streets in Mongkok, the streets were turned into a limbo. And then many Hong Kong people reprimanded the event. They asked that the mobsters should be severely punished, especially those who attacked the police. But unfortunately, a minority of violent separatists led by the Pan Democrats voted against the motion to reprimand the mobsters. They did not reprimand the violence used by mobsters. Rather, they tried to exonerate the mobsters. They said there should be an independent commission of inquiry set up. that there was a problem with the governance of the people. They did not listen to the people, so the people were unhappy, and that is why we had this incident. I, of course, do not agree with the attitude of the Pan-Democrats towards violence. The Civic Party provided free legal support for such mobsters, so the mobsters did not have any worries, and they, in fact, are encouraging violent acts. Where is your conscience? Is it that the governance of the administration is such that they do not listen to the people? Let me try to explore into certain areas. Ever since the setup of the SARG, the Pan-Democrats have positioned themselves as the opposition camp. They are opposed to anything at all. At the same time, they also opposed to the Chinese Communist Party. Anything that has to do with the mainland, whether it be policy or infrastructure, they would object to it. The SRL, NT-Northeast development and Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macau Bridge, they would filibuster in the council here and outside. They would mobilize the objectors, including young people, to adopt violence and charge at the Legislative Council. Ever since the constitutional reform, someone actually planned and made strategies for the Occupy Central movement, and then violence escalated. This time they used bricks, they used steel bars, and they committed arson. Next time there could be more escalation. Violence has its source. Last year, the constitutional reform discussion was fertile soil for violence, and they were testing the bottom line of the police. And the Pan-Democrats only objected for the sake of objection. They said the harsh policies caused all the resistance. They said property prices were high, so young people did not have a roof over their head. And at the same time, they objected to and stood in the way of reclamation and land resumption in NT-Northeast. And they are erecting barriers on the way for the SARG, so there is no effective governance possible. They are only going for their own political goals, Mr. Wang Yongman said. Victory will eventually belong to violent young people. I cannot agree with him. Hong Kong's history proves that adopting violence for political ends will not give you good results. Let us look at the 1957 riot, the 1967 disturbance, the 1981 disturbance, etc. They all go to show that violent approaches will not give you any success, and you will be abandoned by Hong Kong people. This is the year of the monkey. I hope this violent incident or disturbance would be just and a disobedient or rebellious thrust of a monkey. And in the end, the monkey would be constrained and be put under this mountain of five fingers. So he will reflect upon himself, and in the end he will help the monk to go to the west and secure the holy book. These violent young people will not have the support of Hong Kong people because they will harm Hong Kong's stability and prosperity. But if they will right their wrong, then I'm sure they will be back on the right track. Now, I'd like to take the opportunity to make my comments on the PA to the CS, the S4J, and other bureau chiefs. Some opposition camp members say that the governance can be likened to evil laws. I don't agree, but I also see inadequacies in the government's governance. As a legislator, I should make comments in a positive way to the administration so they will listen to us and govern better. Last year, Mr. President, I already said that for people to have a good living, you don't only need a roof over your head, but you need appropriate housing, including a transport network and community facilities, employment, and also living space.
Yeah.
And last year, I said that I was very worried about the capacity of the Yunlong community. I'm afraid that we've reached the cap in terms of our transport network, the shops. We can't support the 1 million population planned there. And also there's a problem with the external transport network in Yunlong. There are now 4 MTR stations, Tin Shui Wai, Longping, Yunlong, and Kamsheng Road. And they are the at the very end of this line. And Yunlong, there are now 600,000 people, and the statistics show that the capacity has reached its peak in the morning hours. And if there are no special trains departing from Tin Shui Wai, those along the line could not get on board at all. And the special trains, well, can only scratch the surface of the problem. They can't resolve the problem altogether. Now, every time the development panel or the development bureau has been lobbying the Yunlong for development projects in Yunlong, and we asked them questions every time about the West Rail capacity, and they said that the capacity will increase by 60%. They use the same figure for Hong Shui Q, Kam Tin, and also Yunlong South. They quote the figure of 60% all the time. But then there will be an increase of population of 400,000 people. That represents 66% of the existing population, and not to mention the population in Tuen Mun. And if there is a new population intake number like that, well, I don't think the transport network, the railway network, would be able to support. Not to mention that we haven't calculated or counted in the population growth in Tuen Mun. The secretary is responsible for transport and housing, and he should coordinate the projects, infrastructure projects and transport projects, so that people will not have any difficulties in commuting to work. I'm sure that the secretary is very familiar with such issues, and he might not agree with my estimated figures, but there is one point that I think the secretary would not dismiss, and that is we need another railway going from NT-West to the urban areas. In the central waters, there is a plan for development, and they have already this idea. We support the study on developing a central an artificial island and central waters, and we hope that there is a direct link between the NT-West and the artificial island and the urban area. We need another cross-harbor rail, so I submit. Dr. Priscilla Leung, well, the council should be operating like what we are seeing in the past few days, that people are debating an issue. Some people support and others oppose the PA. That's no problem, because we represent different opinions, we have different views, and that's all understandable. I hope that Hong Kong's political, economic, and social issues can be discussed in such a civilized manner that we are seeing today. This is accepted by the public. But regrettably, since January 2013, Professor Benny Tsai floated the idea of Occupy Central, and in relation to the rule of law of in Hong Kong, there's already a gap created. He's coming up with excuses for breaking the law. I've talked to him in private, and I persuaded him not to take that route, because it's no way out. You can only have counterproductive effect. before you had negotiations, you were asking the central authorities to go your way, or else you would stage such massive movements. So in terms of the approach, the methodology, there were problems. And ultimately, we couldn't forge a consensus on the political reform, on the rule of law, this concept. That was built over many years. And a lot of Hong Kong people were abiding by the law when they crossed a carriageway. They wouldn't litter casually. So they were law-abiding. They are law-abiding. And this is not something that is easy to come by. I've told Benny Tai, and I said, at the end of the movement, it will be led by the young people, the radical people, and they will kick you out. I'm sure he remembered my remarks, and that conversation took place around March, April 2013. So ultimately, the young people came out. We appreciated their passion, their concern for the community, but we didn't appreciate their approach, and we were worried about their approach as well. Well, no society will come with a perfect legal system. I don't know whether it's coming from Raymond Wong or Lam Kwok Hong. A lot of smokers were very unhappy, and they would also stage a larger-scale movement. Well, there are two groups of people in relation to smoking. Some people don't like to be passive smoker. Some people would like to smoke. So this piece of law may not be able to please both of them. So we have to try to forge consensus among all our differences. That's the most important point. And we have to make sure that peace will prevail. Well, violence is something attractive. Well, just like a child, well, he is very curious, and he put his finger into the power socket, and he might be electrocuted if the adults don't stop him. Now, well, if you say that nobody died when the bricks were thrown, then you think there's no problem. But then, well, what if the bricks kill somebody? That's going to be a big problem. It can be considered a manslaughter. Are the young people prepared to face the consequences if this happens? Are they prepared that they would face great criminal liability? I think there is really a gap here. People think that it's okay to break the law, and that does a lot of damage to Hong Kong. Hong Kong people cherish the rule of law because we want to resolve problems through peaceful means. I like a lot of the TV dramas, and they would have a quarrel, have a fight, and they would say, "Well, I see you in the court," and there's something good if people are not happy with the government. Well, they can seek judicial review. This is this is a peaceful approach to resolve disputes. But then today, we are beginning to see young people not to be going down that route. They are encouraged that they can take, they can be violent, and this is a good first step to make. Hong Kong is not that bad. Our generous society in a sense, because we provide legal aid, legal assistance. The first motion that I moved when I joined Electrical is that we can expand the scope of the legal aid scheme to benefit also the middle class, not just the grassroots. And I also said that if Hong Kong people face disputes on the mainland, they should be entitled to legal aid, because, well, as particular, if they are Hong Kong permanent residents. I deal with many such cases myself. People got problems on the mainland. They have nowhere to turn to at the moment. The Hong Kong offices in the mainland can't help them. I think this is something that the government must consider. It should help Hong Kong people facing problems on the mainland. They've contributed so much to Hong Kong society. It's maybe a critical time for them, and we should provide the legal assistance to them. And what society is Hong Kong now? Last year, I heard that a judge saying that he would rule on cases where personal safety is jeopardized. Now, the police officers are safety are jeopardized when they are enforcing the law. Well, actually, both the judges and the police officers are important pillars of Hong Kong society. Why is that the case? I've talked to judges and I've talked to police officers. They feel very bad. Many colleagues have cited examples. I won't repeat them. They said that they are worried, not because they are afraid that they will be attacked by rioters. But the question is, Hong Kong people can accept that rioters beating up the police officers, and these rioters are even praised for their acts. So this is something very dangerous. And if people, Hong Kong people, lose confidence in the police, and this is going to be a big problem. Well, we still have an excellent police team in Hong Kong. They're very restrained. They would rather be beaten up than beating others. Why is that? There is no death. That's maybe it's one of the reasons is because they are so self-restrained. Hong Kong police team are still a very excellent team by international standards, and don't smear the police officers. What I feel so sad about is there is a kindergarten teacher who told the kindergarten students that these are bad guys, the bad policemen. Well, you shouldn't do that to harm the police out of your own political motives. Well, some police officers may do something wrong. Well, just like doctors, they may do something wrong. But we should adhere to the system. I went on to a program on an English channel, and I talked to this organizer of the riot. And he described it as a war, the riots in Hong Kong. And I was taken aback. And that this was a one-hour program. And the foreigners were telling us, do you know what is a war? Don't you think you are being idiotic? You are telling the young people that this is a war. And there is this foreign commentator asking me, do you know what war is about? Many people would like to come to Hong Kong escaping a war. We are in a very blessed society, but we don't know about it. And two renowned judges also spoke about whether there has been abuse of the judiciary review. They debated with each other. We respect their opinions. But then the courts have been dragged into these political bickering, and this is so very unsatisfactory, and this is so unhealthy. We can't gatekeep this last fortress of ours, and that is going to be a problem. Hong Kong people can't accept filibustering. The opposition can, please don't filibuster. We return to the normal debate as we are seeing. I want to tell so much to the young people. The new student union leader said that he can accept independence of Hong Kong. Well, I feel so sad. This route doesn't work. Don't be misled by others. Don't believe that this is a way out. Several years ago, a friend asked me to watch this U.S. Film or drama, and that was shown to those aged 13 to 17, year way back then. And now this group of people have become 20. Now, in 2000, the U.S. election, Gore lost to Bush. He got more votes, but he lost. And because this is in a perfect U.S. Political system, and he had two routes to take. One, he could incite his supporters to stage a riot, or the second route is to take the case to court. And he finally chose to the second route and take the case to court. And he lost the case, and he told the supporters that, "I appreciate your feelings. I know that you are disappointed." Well, I was disappointed too, but we had to accept the court's ruling, and we would not let our disappointment prevail over our love for the nation. And he can't say something like that at this juncture. And if Hong Kong people really cherish the peace in Hong Kong, the rule of law, the civilization in Hong Kong, please stop the violence. So I speak. Does any other member wish to speak? Dr. Elizabeth Kwart.
President, recently, whether I've been walking on the streets or meeting different organizations, I frequently heard these two words. The first is chaos. Second, barbarians. Well, Hong Kong is really very chaotic. We all feel so. And when has it all started? My experience and logic tell me that perhaps chaos started here, from handing of bananas to glass bottles. Glass. From chanting a few slogans and a few placards to a lot of slogans, a lot of placards, and people rushing out. And whenever they don't like it, they launch personal attacks. This is not a place for discussing matters, but for personal attacks. Chaos spread from the council to Occupy Central. In the Occupy movement the year before last, we saw banners glamorizing illegal behavior. They talk about justice and they charge at police officers, and they say Hong Kong is now in a mess and they would like to overturn the government. And in Legco, everything is being opposed. This will make it difficult to govern Hong Kong. And when the government fails, people out there would criticize the government for not being able to do anything. Then after the Occupy movement, people talk about civil disobedience, and they say that they are very heroic, and then the prosecution process is very slow, and the sentences are very light, and when they are convicted, they come out showing this sign of victory. It appears that Hong Kong, you don't have to pay any price for breaking the law, and they are now heroes, and any illegal behavior seems to be well justified. And what will happen if this is to go on? Right from the beginning of the Occupy movement, we already said that if you encourage law-breaking behavior, things may run out of control. If you support someone setting fire, the fire may run out of control. Finally, on the first day of the Lunar New Year, we saw the riot in Mong Kok. On the TV screen, we saw many people assaulting the police, hurling bricks at them, and continue to beating up a policeman after he had fallen to the ground. And they set fires at 22 locations, trying to add kerosene, and they stopped fire officers from putting out the fire. And according to the director of fire services, some place bricks at the wheels of fire engines to stop them from reaching the scene. What if there was a major fire? It's really fortunate that we did not have a major blaze. I think what they did was directly affecting the safety and property of the public. Many of them wore masks, perhaps probably to evade responsibility so that they will not be recognized, and even if arrested, the true identity might not be revealed. Now, if they are really so heroic, and if they think what they did was so right, they shouldn't have put up face masks. And what did the pandemocrats say? They said that the uprising was caused by official oppression. They said that first it was because a crackdown on hawkers on the first day of the Lunar New Year, stopping people from earning a few thousand dollars. So it was confirmed afterwards that there was no arrest of hawkers. Rather, the FEHD officers were besieged, so they had to call the police for help. Were hawkers arrested? No. And who made it impossible for hawkers to do business? those who set fires, who caused a riot by charging at law enforcement agencies. And then they said that it's because of the political system. Many pan-democrats said during these few days of debate that because we didn't have universal suffrage, because of the political system, we had that riot. What logic is it? Well, these riots are seen in the U.S. and also Southeast Asian countries. Don't they have universal suffrage there as well? They do. So what has riots got to do with the political system? And then they would say, no, it's because of Cy Leung. Because Cy Leung is the CE, we have riots, all right? Cy Leung being the CE will lead to riots. What kind of logic is it? When leader's popularity is low, that would be riots. But what about Germany? Isn't there a prime minister? Doesn't their prime minister enjoy high popularity rating? But there were riots there as well. And then they would say, Lee Cheuk-yan said that it's because of social conflicts and riots are inevitable. Well, you can go look for more excuses and defenses and see whether people will believe you. Violence is violence. There can be no excuse and no defense. I think there are people who have been condoning and glamorizing violence, and that's the cause. If there is any causal relationship, I think it all started with hurling of objects in this council, spreading to the community, and things have gone out of control. Beating up people, arson, is violence, is irresponsible, people will get hurt, and that is disturbing the law and order of Hong Kong, undermining the rule of law and the overall interest of Hong Kong. There can be no reason, no excuse. Don't use this tortured argument to contaminate the minds of our young people. Don't think that Hong Kong people are fools. Violence has been escalating. Faced with these organized rioters, the government must have new measures and targeted legislation to cater for all eventualities. I've urged the administration to consider legislating to ban the wearing of face masks. In protests in Germany, it is against the law for you to hide your identity in a protest, and the maximum penalty can 1 year of imprisonment. In France, the law is also very strict. No one is allowed to hide his face in the public, and the same with the U.S. Washington state legislate against that. Anyone who violates that rule will be fined $100 and imprisoned. And in Canada, people are not allowed to wear face masks in protests and public assemblies. The maximum penalty is 10 years of imprisonment, but the only defense is for medical reasons. So I think I am only talking about people engaging in illegal assemblies and riots. I propose this so as to increase the deterrent effect to deter young people from engaging in illegal assemblies and riots and trying to hide their faces behind masks. Of course, this is but one of the measures. The police should step up its equipment and gear and evidence and intelligence gathering tactics. And most important of all, we should not glamorize such behavior. The most worrying thing is the sense of violence is spreading, in particular among young people. And people still continue to feel this. They say that they should use violence to stop brutality, and there is no bottom line when it comes to charging. Aren't you worried? I am. Their aim is wrong. It's entirely wrong. They say that they want to overrule the government, and according to Lee Cheuk-yan, they must have a say over the political entity. I think this is separatism, and I can anticipate more and more such riots. to solve this problem, we should not glamorize such behavior. And more importantly, families and schools must enhance a moral and civic education for their children to help them to build up healthy values. Values will affect our judgment. Young people's values are affected by families, schools, peers, and the social environment. How can we let young people understand that no one can use violence to hurt other people, regardless of the reason or excuse? And violence is not the solution. I think this is the duty of everyone, not just the government. Every parent, every teacher, everyone here, our behavior is affecting young people, and it's best to teach by our own model. If even legislators think that using physical violence by hurling objects, they can resolve the disputes here, how can we educate young people not to resort to violence? We shouldn't forget that this Mr. Wang, the police officer who was injured in the Mong Kok riot, he said, we must not give up on young people. Yes, we should not give up on young people. And we should start from ourselves. I appeal to members, be good role models and do not poison young people. And Hong Kong is chaotic. And I think another reason is the bogus refugees. They have caused problems and they're affecting our law and order. In fact, we wanted to help the people who are genuinely persecuted. But now we have over 10,000 overstayers. They are claimants and we can only handle about 2,000 cases per year. We're spending $200 million on that, and only less than 1% of them have been routed to be genuine refugees. The situation is worsening. Every day we see an influx of such fake refugees. Just this morning, Oriental Daily has given us a chart. From the beginning of this year to now, there have been 43 crimes related to these refugees. Assault, possession of weapons, a sale of counterfeit cigarettes, and robbery, snatching, so on and so forth. Yesterday, in the village house in Yuen Long, 800,000 worth of cocaine was seized, and one woman was arrested. In this year's PA, there's the proposal to expedite the procedures to increase manpower and to step up the penalty. This is good. I hope the administration can adopt a multi-pronged approach and fix the problem. However, all these take time and it cannot be achieved overnight. So my proposal to the administration is to set up a preliminary screening mechanism, use administrative measures to screen out some blatantly fake cases. For instance, some foreign domestic helpers, when they have worked in Hong Kong few years before they're about to leave, they claim that they are refugees, or they claim protection under the Convention on Torture. I think these are blatantly fake cases and they can be screened out in the first instance. Of course, the administration may be worried that rejection of these cases may lead to judicial reviews. Well, if we are justified, I think we have nothing to fear. If we can screen out part of them, at least it can help to a certain extent. And DAB is aware that many of these IIs came to Hong Kong through the mainland. And yesterday, we announced that NPC delegates and CPPCC of DAB would suggest that intelligence sharing and gathering be stepped up in the upcoming meetings of the two political bodies so that we can do more to crack down on these fake refugees. All right, the second word is barbarous. Hong Kong used to be renowned for its flexibility. We were able to respond to things very quickly. And people would say that in Hong Kong, people don't walk, they run. And for this button to close a door, well, it's not seen in other places. But in Hong Kong, we're so eager that we press the button to close the lift door ASAP.
But in recent times, we are not quick anymore. We are very slow. We drag our feet on everything. Why is it that we used to be so quick, now we are so slow? One of the reasons, of course, is filibuster. We don't need to say more about it. You all know that our filibuster is really filibuster, and it's filibuster on everything. So we are dragging our feet on many things. And secondly, judicial review, abuse of the JR process slows down many things. I heard Mr. Dennis Kwok of the Civic Party say that all the policies of this government are wrong. He went on and on as if the administration has accomplished nothing. I think it's very unfair to the civil service. The civil service in Hong Kong has always been professional and excellent. I believe the civil service has also made many good policies, but PAN Democrats make no mention of that. They only criticize. And why are we moving slowly now? I think our councillors can all see this. Officials use a whole lot of time to be answerable to members. They wait for meetings. They attend filibuster meetings. I believe the CS and every level of officials have to sit in the waiting room to wait for the filibuster of the FC to end. They don't know whether to stay or to go, and they have wasted a lot of time and energy. And since there is criticism against everything, and there is distrust towards all officials and whatever they say, then some officials may think, I shouldn't say so much, I shouldn't do so much. Let us prefer to be conservative, let us do more studies and consultancies. So everything has slowed down. PAN Democrats also say that somebody resorted to violent resistance because there is system violence in the council and because social systems are not sound. I have heard radical young people say that is because PAN Democrats cannot achieve anything in the council and they want to vote them out so radical young people can join the council. And Mr. Lee Cheuk-yan asked the administration and officials whether they have reflected upon themselves, whether they need to take up any responsibility for the riot incident, whether young people were compelled to go to the streets by officials. But I'd like to ask the PAN Democrats, especially Lee Cheuk-yan, do they also have some responsibility also? They object to anything that's related to the mainland, the government, and CY Leung. They get personal and on everything. They only talk about resistance. They don't really discuss policies and debate policies seriously. They are irrational. Can you promote good policies if that is your attitude? Can you discharge your responsibility as councillors? Are you working for the good of Hong Kong? How can you convince the public you're working for them? How can you not disappoint the young? To be frank, if you see a problem in society, you ask the administration to come up with a policy. It's not easy. You need to spend a lot of energy to secure support. You have to research into the policies of many countries. You have to lobby the officials and the public. It's really difficult, but it's not impossible. Let me give you a few examples, and this is my experience. In 2001, I started to mount the barrier-free internet. The CS was a department head at that time. We wanted to narrow or fill the digital divide. We know that elderly people and disabled people could not surf the net, so we wanted to promote government policies to fill this digital divide so people can use the internet and the enjoy the convenience of brought by technology. I know it was after a few years that the government worked with us, and then different sectors worked with us. And now, over 30% of elderly people know how to use the internet. And I asked the officials at the ITB panel, and it was found that the elderly are still using the software that I advocated 10-odd years ago. Meaning, if there is no updating, then people will just follow what they have been doing. In 2003, we had SARS. Together with the IT sector, we wrote a white paper to the administration to promote electronic medical records for all. It was only last year that the law on electronic medical records was passed. Cervical cancer vaccination is the only vaccination that can help women prevent cervical cancer. I hope Hong Kong girls can enjoy free vaccination. I spent 6 years. And this year, I'd like to thank CE and Mr. Ko Wing Man for saying in the PA that the administration said grassroots girls would be able to receive the vaccination for free. I will continue to work hard, hoping to extend this to all girls in Hong Kong. The INTB, 8 years ago, together with the sector, we marched in the streets to try to secure an IT bureau. And smuggling of wildlife, I knew Hong Kong was a center for ivory trade. 2 years ago, I started to do lobbying work, and I'm happy to see in the policy address this year that the administration would be happy to combat illegal ivory trade. But to have a policy on that, maybe we need 3 to 5 years more. I cited all these examples to tell you that it's not easy to promote policies. But unlike what the pandemocrats say, the administration does listen. It is not that they stonewall you, whatever you say. It is not that they only do things that the public do not like. That's not true. There are many good policies, especially in this term of government. I see many officials and civil servants are working hard to solve social problems. Many of them are historical legacies. It's like the housing problem. Very often you need a consensus to be forged. You need to persist on promoting it. If every member tries very hard and persists in the effort, I'm sure we can promote many policies. I've been in the council for some years, but I have not been able to do something with one policy, and that is to prevent more harm done to victims of sexual offences. We had asked for a special access or a screen, or that the victims could do testifying from another room. Miss Emily Lau said to me, "Hey, look, I have been trying to secure it for over 10 years, but nothing came out of it." Today, the CS is here, or the S4J is here. I hope I don't have to spend another 10 years like Miss Emily Lau. I will continue to fight hard for it. Last year, finally, we had the INTB set up. The PA says we should promote a smart city. Now we faced with very slow pace and a difficult situation. I hope we can have a smart government. I hope departments can make use of creative methods and use big data and the technology platform to solve social problems and come up with new policies as soon as possible. I'm from the IT sector and also the business sector. Large conglomerates have been consolidating data, so their leadership will be able to know what happens in real time from the window they allow customers to shop from to back office support. They can also do simulation to do projections, so they can respond quickly to situations and also make strategies for the future. The Hong Kong government can become the next generation smart government. I think you have the conditions for that because you have electronized all data. You also have electronic map resources. You just have to include different tiers of information on top of the electronic data map so your governance can be helped. I would propose that you consolidate data of all departments as soon as possible and see how we can leverage on technology so that in this situation, you can allow the administration to govern with more openness and transparency. I also hope you can apply new mindset to resolve social problems. Actually, many social issues do not have to fall squarely on the shoulder of the administration. Mr. President, if I ask you how many vacant parking spaces are there in Central and Admiralty, if I am coming in from Causeway Bay, which route should I take? Where can I find a parking space the soonest? Mr. President, I don't think you can answer the question. Neither can I. Nobody can. But if we were in Shenzhen, then at least there would be three or four softwares, and I can use my smartphone to tell you which route I should use, where is the cheapest parking space, so you do not have to circulate at grade, and we can reduce air pollution because the Shenzhen government allows data to be opened up for market participation. If every service is done by the government and if we apply old mindsets, actually you should apply new mindset and make use of a shared economy so government service can be shared with the market. More information and data of the government can be opened up for the market, so we will have more social services and there will be people who can give you ideas and partner with you in solving the problems. Mr. President, we face challenges both outside and inside. There is a lot of risk in the world economy. World stock markets are volatile, and inside, the tourism industry is going through a bitter winter. The retail sector is crying out for help. We have bogus refugees. We also have riots in our streets. We want to solve all these problems. I believe, like many Hong Kong people, we all love Hong Kong. We want to do good for Hong Kong. We don't want to see chaos in Hong Kong. We all hope that we can focus on resolving economic and livelihood issues. There are many more problems waiting to be resolved. If we want to do that, Hong Kong people must stand together. I hope that everybody can put aside their prejudice, hatred, violence, because only a peaceful and stable Hong Kong can allow all of us to live and work happily here. Only when there is no violence in Hong Kong can our next generation grow up healthily here. That's all from me, President. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Wong Kwok-hing? President, I only have 7 minutes 18 seconds, but as I said on the first day, I will make comments on the PA in such a way that I would give credit where credit is due. Yesterday, I gave praises, and today I must criticize the PA out of 261 paragraphs. On the issue of labor rights, there are only two paragraphs. Only two. Really, too little, too few. And the worst is, there is a line saying there is a need to import labor. The FTU has cried foul about it, but the government, the CS, the department chiefs made a statement to say that they would first of all have to protect the interests of local workers, and they would not circumscribe the mechanism of the LAB.
Well, even if this is what they said, we're still disappointed or dissatisfied with the neglect of the workers' interest in this policy address. But I must point out that among all the members who have spoken, they have not mentioned this. And why is he neglecting this front? I would like to highlight this. Mr. Vincent Fang from the Liberal Party and other members of the Liberal Party have spoken. And they said that they have 300 votes in the election committee. How many votes do the labor sector have? This is exactly why CY has made this biased decision in the circumstance. Honestly, before the election of the electoral term next, if we have one man, one vote to return the CE, and that the CE will not be returned by 1,200 people, but rather 3 million eligible voters in Hong Kong, then CY has to consult the 7 million people in Hong Kong, and he cannot and should not neglect the labor's interest. He should be accountable to the workers. And also, offsetting mechanism for the MPF, retirement protection, standard working hours, raising the statutory minimum wage, and all these can be done. How? But why can't that be done? And that's because last year, the political reform failed. And the one man, one vote approach is not passed. And consequently, the universal suffrage can't be implemented for electoral election as well. In this debate, all the members from the pan-democratic camp who have spoken, they said that CY is likes stirring up troubles, he's combative, and they accused the existing system as being tyrannical. So that's why they staged the fishboard revolution, the umbrella revolution. They justify all these violent actions. I would like to ask, you said CY Leung was gained 689 votes out of 1,200 votes, and you think it's not right? Why are you still embracing this election committee, 1,200 strong election committee? You think that the proposal comes with screening, and then you don't support the approach. You voted down on the constitutional reform package, and that was a cause why the government has not been governing properly. You said CY Leung was very bad. Why don't you allow 3 million people to vote for the CE, and rather you chose the 1,200 people to vote? I think you are practicing double standards. Yes? Point of order. He said, CY said, if 3 million voters can vote, then the representatives from the poor people will be elected. Can you clarify? He's slamming Cy Lao. Please sit down. Can you clarify? He can't criticize Cy Leung. The CE should not be criticized as lightly. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, please sit down. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong is one of the members of the Pan Democratic camp who is receiving black money, so to speak, and he is opposing the political reform package. And he said that, is it the case that I received money from Jimmy Lai, and then if people earning a salary of one below 14,700, then they have the right to elect the CE, then there will be bias towards the poor if the CE is elected in such a way. Please, maintain order and stop Leung Kwok Hong from interrupting my speech. So all Hong Kong people, all workers, you should understand this. It's not the case that Cy Leung doesn't want to make reforms. And in this term of government, Mr. Leung is a very brave reformer amidst all these challenges. At first, he challenged the property hegemony. Mr. Wong, please stop. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, what's the point of order that you would like to raise? The rules of procedures of the LegCo said that LegCo members can lie. Well, is there such a provision? Well, he can tell lies, but he should tell in a better way. Is a legal advisor? It's in 94, section 94 of ROP. Is that right? Well, please don't interrupt, or I'll rule your being engaged in misconduct. Now, because I was criticizing Leung Kwok Hong, of course, he would jump upon me. Mr. Leung is a very brave reformer amidst all the difficulties. He challenged the property hegemony, he identified land for building housing, and he launched all these cooling measures. And in face of the political forces which are anti-communist and which advocate for independence, he still insisted and remained dedicated to his work. Well, never have we seen that the LegCo is asking for the CE to step down and overturn him. No matter is the 79-day occupation movement, the opposition here at the council, and also the riots on the first day of Lunar New Year. All these are interconnected. So please, I ask the members of the public to read this book on Occupy Central Movement. So in that circumstance, I hope, or the FTU is striving for returning the CE by one man, one vote. If that can be realized ASAP, then the workers' problems, labor issues can be naturally resolved. And we will not be seeing the situation today where we are seeing procrastination, all sides of people's power, the League of Social Democrats, and so on. They are the parties who defend most the vested interest, the property developers' interest. They are not really sincere in working for the benefits of Hong Kong and not working for the benefit of the social workers. Why are they moving all these amendments? If you support one man, one vote to return the CE, then everything can be resolved. Does any other member wish to speak? You have used up all your speaking time. Well, he is smearing CY Leung, CE. Will you ask him to clarify? Because he's also criticizing me. According to the rules of procedure, I can ask him for a clarification. I strongly condemn Leung Kwok Hong for disrupting my speech and disrupting the order of the proceedings. Mr. Wong Kwok-hing is Yun Mok. Does any other member wish to speak? The Secretary for Justice.